Have you got that, Raji? It should be with you now.
Yeah, I'm just accepting it.
Awesome.
You're able to see me, hear me?
Yeah.
Perfect. Just give me a moment, I'll share my screen. I hope my screen is visible.
Yep, we can see that.
Yeah, sure. Good afternoon, everybody, or rather, good evening. It's afternoon here in India. I'm doing this virtually. So last time we were there in February and in December as well to meet you all in person and do it, different meetups. I think this is yet another group. Happy to meet you all virtually. I'm sharing a different screen. So if you have any difficulty or if you face any difficulty in hearing me or listening to me, just I would request my co-trainers to voice over so that I can pause and continue from where I left, because I cannot look into the chat and the other things here. I'm sharing a different screen.
No worries. We're all awesome.
Perfect. So I'll be talking about why DevOps and SRE are essential. Possibly I'll run this presentation for 30, 35 to 40 minutes or less than that. And then I'll take questions towards the end. So feel free to ask your questions in the question box and we'll have it as a discussion towards the end. With that note, I get started. So the topics that I will be covering today are about the evolution of application architecture, how things were, how the client-server architecture was 20 years ago, 30 years ago, and how the things have evolved to what it is today. And then I'll go on to talk about what is SRE, what is DevOps, what are the differences, what are the similarities, and then about the challenges that SRE would be facing. And then about how monitoring tools are important for SRE challenges, because how the tools will be able to help them. And when you go about tools, and when you start using multiple tools, there are some problems associated with that. So I'll talk about the problems in multi-vendor tools and then about the full stack monitoring solution as a suggestion that I'll be talking about. So first, let's get started with evolution of application architecture. So as I said, the client-server architecture itself, that's the base of any application building, right? You have a server component, you have a client component, and you write both those components, and that's how applications are built. So this is how it was typically, a server component that is residing somewhere within your premise, within your organization. That's the server part. And then the client. Client used to connect from using your desktop. Sometimes, I mean, the 30 years ago, it was only that the client were also built within the organization itself. You had the client component also within the organization. Everything was on-premise. Then with Web 2.0, technologies, cloud started picking up. People started, web was not just considered a medium of consuming content, but web was also seen as a medium of contributing content. People started writing their content and started uploading. People started uploading their images and videos. That's when the cloud started picking up. And then the clients started connecting through cloud to the different servers, that the server component that we had. And then it went on to become the public clouds. Public cloud vendors started picking up where we had, we have different vendors now. So it's no longer that you have to make use or you have to use only your server component within your premise. You can just make use of the infrastructure that is already available, that is hosted as a service, and then connect your client from wherever you are. But public clouds have not completely taken over, because there are still businesses, there are still organizations who want to run it in a hybrid fashion. So they have private clouds as well as public clouds. So that's what this, the hybrid faction, hybrid cloud servers that exist. So this is how it has evolved from 1.0, 2.0, Web 3.0, Web 4.0, and things like that. So this goes on to say that what was a monolith architecture where the business logic or the data access, the user interface, the back and front and everything used to be, though they are components, they used to be as one big mega system. It's a one big monolith. Something fails, the whole system fails. From monolith architecture, the things have evolved to become microservices. Now, everything that you do, be it the business logic, the data access layer, the user interface layer, whatever you want to do, all of them has become small container components. You can run each of them independently. You can run, you can build, you can test, you can deploy each of them at its own pace. It's no longer a big monolith. It's all smaller micro components. And it might look very simple, very nice, very easy to do. So all of them are individual components. I can work on my own so I can do releases quickly. But the complexity lies in managing and monitoring the system. Because things are all moving towards microservice, how do you make sure that you will know which component is failing? How do you make sure that the one component failure doesn't lead to a cascading, doesn't have a cascading effect and affect the entire system? Earlier, the entire system will be down. We know that. But today, finding out which component has failed has all been a great challenge. Every system or any change has its own plus and minus. Though we can do quicker releases and the technologies have improved to use it on the cloud, there are challenges associated with it. And how, wherever there is a challenge, that's going to be a tool to help you with addressing those challenges. So those are some things that we'll be discussing today. I'll give you some quick internet stats. I've taken it from, you can just go search for the stats. It's all available. So it goes on to say that, I forgot to update the presentation, even as on August 2020, the numbers are the same. There are 4.54 billion internet users across the globe. And 1.92 billion people do online purchase, right? We're all, everything is gone online now. Any meetup or any purchasing or any segment you take, retail, automobile, everything has gone online. Schools are all become online now. It's all, my children attend classes only from home. So that is both a plus as well as a minus. So there are 2 billion websites on the World Wide Web, and every day, 100,000 domains are getting registered. So it's not one or two. Every day, new businesses are being born. Either new businesses are being born or existing on-premise businesses are moving to the cloud. So cloud adoption has started picking up. In such a scenario, how do you make sure your business stays on top of your competition? How do you make sure you will be able to win your customers? How do you make sure you retain your customers as loyal customers? Because customer retention, customer loyalty, those are all very, very important. So how you will be able to do all that? By ensuring great end user experience. Experience is what matters, right? Even the two products, the same comparison and features, but how you give the experience could be in the form of how they access the client. The experience could be in the form of how your customer support is handling the support with them, how you are talking to them. How, all these matters. Only by ensuring great end user experience, you will be able to deliver or you will be able to retain your customers that has happy customers and be stay ahead of your competition. So when you have to retain them as happy customers and you have to take care of end user experience, what is important is performance. That's when I always say this, or we as an organization, we always say this from Site24/7, slow is the new down. There is no point in having all your resources up and running if they are going to be performing very, very slow, because none of us has the time or patience to sit through pages that are going to take forever to load, right? That instant gratification is what is killing us now. I want it now, immediately. Something is not working, I'll just switch and I'll move on. So that's how the whole world is. When you go for search for something in any search engine, how many of us go to the second or third page? We don't. We just settle with what is available in the first few links. Try to get from that, be it a product or you search for any article, anything. So to get there, get in the top slots, performance is important. People expect only 2 seconds for loading the page. That's the time that people expect. How do you make sure you're able to do that? That is very important, and performance is important if you have to give great end user experience. So with that introduction, let me get into what is the picture that I have for DevOps and SRE, because we often hear this and there are various talks. I have listened to various talks. I have read various articles. So there will be slight difference, slight similarities. So there are, I mean, I'm sure all of you know this, but I have a different way of representing this. So what is DevOps? So this is, there used to be a stream, or there is still a stream called developers who take care of writing code, compiling it, bundling it as a product. With that, they think their job is over. That's all used to be the role of a developer. And then they will pass it on to another person called operator, who actually takes care of deploying the build, attending to end user complaints, look at any problems, keeping up with SLAs. Now with SREs, there are these three different terms that we have. SLAs are important, SLO is important, service level objectives, service level indicators, SLIs. So those are all the added factors that has added to SREs. I'll come to that later. So with respect to operators, these used to be their role. So they take care of the performance, they attend to customer complaints. So those were the normal, typical role of an operator. But with these, what is it, changing technologies, with the microservices coming up, with web technologies picking up, these two roles merged and they became DevOps. So DevOps is more like a philosophy, or the set of processes, or the role definition is more like a person who should have some amount of knowledge of what is happening in development, from writing code to what is happening in the deployment level when you deploy and run the application. So that's what is DevOps. DevOps, we call it as a cycle, which is a, what is it, quicker feedback, fail fast and release. Those are all the principles that we talk about DevOps. Now let's come to what is SRE then. There is always this, both are same or different. I see them as DevOps and SRE are two sides of the same coin. If DevOps is about what to do, SRE is about how to do. So you can just get that from this words itself. So it is, if the DevOps talks about the principles and processes, SRE talks this about actually getting down and doing it. So if I have to say this differences as some points, these are all very straightforward things. DevOps connects development and operation. So that's what we saw as that picture. While SRE is more operation oriented, they are more to do with the focused towards production setup, whereas DevOps is set of principles, processes that you follow for product releases, configuration managements, accept it's okay to fail and let's take failure as normal and move on. Those are all some of the philosophies of DevOps, while SRE is more focused towards production setup. What is, if something fails, what is the root cause of that failure? How much time, how much error percentage do I have for me to fail? And how do I monitor, or the events, the alerts that I get? What if some incident happens, how do I make sure that doesn't happen again? Can I reduce the fault? Can I take care of automation and reduce the occurrences of failures? How quickly do I have to respond to incidences? Those are all the actual roles of the SRE itself, which goes on to say the primary focus of SRE is reliability, trust. Trust that the site will be up and running without any issues all the time. Well, DevOps primary focus is the delivery speed, how quickly they are able to do releases following agile principles and so on. So it's only slight differences. So in Java terminologies, it is said as SRE implements DevOps. DevOps is the interface or the abstraction. SRE implements that and adds more value to it so that they take care of the reliability of the system. So that's what is the difference or similarity between DevOps and SRE. So if I have to say, we talked about the cloud architecture or how the client servers have evolved and how web has taken up. So I categorize any cloud architecture as four layers, which are nothing but your end user layer, where actually your cloud clients connect, then the application layer, that is the SaaS layer where your applications are hosted, the business logic, actual business logic lies there. Then the platform layer, platform as a service for your caches, NoSQL, queues, microservices, containers. Then the actual infrastructure layer, which has your physical servers, virtual servers, cloud servers, firewall, network, load balancer, all of this put together is what is the cloud architecture. And be it DevOps or SRE, they have to take care of what is happening in all these layers. They have to know what is happening in all these layers. They just can't say that I will only focus on one layer because it's all in the cloud. A problem in one place could be because of various factors. It could be because there is a problem in my application connecting with the database. It could be because there is an ISP that is causing an issue for me while it's working fine for some other user. It could be because my network or the switch is having a problem. So the problem could be in any layer. The SRE or DevOps should know what is happening in all these layers. And that can be done with the help of monitoring tools. So this is how I see DevOps and SRE as. So let me go on to say or talk about SRE challenges. Do you think, Amanda, we have to run a poll here with this monotonous and I'm talking, or shall I continue?
We can launch a poll if you want. Are you happy
to make any of them? Yeah, sure. Can you just run a poll?
Sure, of course.
Go on to the SRE challenges.
Yep.
So I'll just give 20 seconds for people to answer this. So it will be. So that will also give us an insight for us as to what are your major stress factors at work before we get to talking about what are the challenges that really an SRE faces. Because I am from a product perspective who gives tools for SREs, but you are all the actual field person out there who are you actually facing the problem and using the tool. So I would want to, or we would want to hear from you, what could be your stress-causing factors at work. Thank you so much. I'll just continue. Amanda, maybe you can wait for 20 more seconds and you can close this. We have two more polls on the way. So I'll just continue with my presentation.
Sure.
Yeah. So what are the SRE challenges? There are many challenges. Every person, every day, they face a lot of challenges. So I am going to talk about some five important challenges for SREs. First one is availability, right? Of course, that's very important because being on the cloud at all layers, it could be your website, it could be your application, it could be your platform, it could be your server infrastructure components. All of these layers have to be up and running. So that is the primary challenge for SRE. That's the primary challenge. And industry standards claim actually 99.9% availability is fine, but that is actually a bit older. With this newer technologies coming up where you have the primary data center, you have secondary data center, you have a read-only setup, there are facilities available for you to take care of availability. There are vendors who take care of them. So now people have started expecting 99.999% available. The systems have to be almost close to 100, but this is what the expectancy is. We cannot say it is 100%. There could be some problem, but these numbers have, in a month, if 99.9% says that in a month you can have some 30 minutes downtime, I'm just giving a number, I have not calculated. This is to further reduce that. You can only allow 10 minute downtime per month or things like that, because there are technologies available. You just have to make use of them. So that has become the expectancy of people because there are competition who does that. You have to be in line with them. So availability is important. The second important thing, as I said earlier, also is about performance. So how quickly are your systems able to respond? How quickly are you able to, where is the response time? Or how? Where is the split up? It is taking more time. Is it in your database calls or is it in your front end? You must know that. And people are expecting, as I said earlier, 2 seconds. So how is your performance? How is your response time? So those are some things that is again another challenge for SRE. The third important challenge that people face is with respect to scalability, right? When you are out there doing a business, your product is becoming a hit, you're going to see sudden surge like this pipe piper. You're going to see a sudden surge in people coming to your website. Are you prepared to handle that scale? That's the greatest challenge. Because if you have not planned for it, you're going to be in trouble. People are coming to you because your business is of value, your application is of value, and they want to use it. There could be some cases where people, there could be some, what do you call, some New Year sale that you are running, where you are expecting more people to come. Have you prepared for the scalability of the system? Can you add more systems dynamically to take care of the scale? Is your infrastructure capable enough to handle that? Is your application code capable enough to handle that? Have you split your infrastructure into different modules so that you can just quickly add more resources to it? So scalability becomes very important. You have to keep that in mind. That is a challenge to take care. And it also to do with capacity planning. We all know SRE's one of the main goal is capacity planning. That comes in because scalability becomes a problem. You must be able to scale up as well as scale down, not unnecessarily use the resources and waste money. So you must be able to scale down when the system is underutilized. So those things have to be planned and prepared, and that is again a challenge for SRE. Security. This is another greatest challenge, right? Because now things are all in the cloud. It is important you have to take care that your data is secure. Your customer data is secure. You make sure that one user's data shouldn't be visible to another user. Hackers will try to get in at some layer or the other. They would try to get in through a front-end service, or they could try to see if there is a hole in your application layer, or if there is a hole in the third-party tool that you are using. Could be anything. Security is important. You have to make sure that people are trusting you and using your tool and giving their data to you, which means you have to live up to that expectation. And security is very, very important. That trust factor is important for businesses to grow. This is, again, you need to take care of your SSL certificates or your brand reputations. All those have to be monitored and taken care. Security is another challenge. Other important challenge with respect to SREs is this failure isolation. How quickly are you able to isolate where the problem is? I'm sure you all remember this ship, right? It sunk under the sea now. The corner place where the hero and heroine of the movie, the Titanic, they took the picture. I'm sure all of us would have watched that. What was the problem? What happened? There was one by mistake, or by they didn't see it, or whatever could have happened. A small hit in one place went to the whole ship to be sunk. That I'm able to relate this to your failure isolation. Your application system should have the capability to isolate when something goes wrong and make sure the other components are running. Don't build it as one interlocked mega system where a small hit is going to bring down your entire system. Split them as smaller components. Have them as smaller grids. Possibly your client server, client applications can be a separate grid. Your schedule servers can be a separate grid. Your data collection can be a separate grid. Your API response can be a separate grid. Only if you have them separated like this, even if there is going to be a problem in one place, the others will go on. If there is a problem in the front end, it's only going to affect the system, or you can say your users, don't worry, we take care of data collection. The schedules are all not affected. They're all happening fine. It's just that some minor issue with respect to the front end grid, which when solved, you can see all the monitored component in your client. So such failure isolation and finding the root cause, quickly responding to incidents, those are all important challenges for SREs, because they are the ones who take care of the production environment. They stand in the front fold of the production system. So failure isolation is important. So these five are the major challenges: availability, performance, scalability, security, and failure isolation. So if they are able to take care of this, they'll be able to run a good show and maintain the system at a good level. So to take care of those, they have to make use of monitoring tools. So I'm just going to give a quick stats on why monitoring tools are important. I'm sure I've talked about this in other talks as well. If you have listened, it might be a repeat for you. I'll just quickly rush through this because this is relevant to this talk that I'm doing now. So the average cost of downtime is measured as 260,000 per hour. So how do you measure this downtime? There is a formula to calculate this downtime. If your resources are going to be down for some time, what is the cost of downtime per hour? How do you calculate that? There are four components to it. The first component is lost revenue. There is going to be a loss in revenue when you are going to have a downtime. How do you calculate loss in revenue? It is revenue per hour into number of hours your system has been down. So that's the lost revenue component. The second component is lost productivity. Because the systems are all on the cloud, you're also using the same systems for your own development. When the systems go down, you will not be able to do any productive work. How do you calculate lost productivity? It's employee salary per hour into number of employees into number of hours the system has been down. So that's how you calculate lost productivity. The third component is recovery cost. There could be some problem. There is some problem that has happened. How do you recover? How do you repair? There has to be some replacements, some data recovery has to be done. The cost spent for all that is your recovery cost. There is this one more, the fourth important factor, that is your intangible cost. The brand image or the reputation, once it is lost, it's impossible to get back the same for your application or for your business. So all of this put together is what is giving us that number. So it is important to make sure that you don't let your systems down. So it's not just the revenue loss. Revenue loss is only the tip of the iceberg. There are going to be customer churns. There are going to be employee frustration because there's going to be blame game. Who caused this issue? I'm not able to work now. You are the reason for this problem. So all this is going to have an impact in your brand reputation. And this is only going to increase your mean time to detect and mean time to repair. So make sure your systems don't go down. So I'll just run a quick survey I did a quick survey on how companies use technologies to run their businesses and provide great user experience. So I've had my friends in different organizations. So when I did this survey, we found out that technologies in businesses are categorized as five important things, partly cloud. The newer businesses that are starting up are all becoming to be in the cloud. There are still on-premise solutions. People still don't want to get to the cloud and they are having it in-house within themselves. Some of them are homegrown, legacy systems. They don't want to adapt any open standards or any standard technologies. They have their own legacy system. They write tools for that legacy system. They own everything by themselves. They don't use any open standards or do they go to the cloud. But majority of them said they are using apps from multiple vendors. I talked about different layers, right? We had the end user layer, the application layer, the platform layer, or the infrastructure layer. Find out who's the best player in the application layer. Let me use that product or that software for monitoring applications. Find out who's the best player in the infrastructure server layer. Let me use that for my server monitoring. That is how typically people used, and that's going to be a hodgepodge. And if you have tools from different vendors, this is how your integration will be. I call this as information spaghetti. Because what you need at the end of the day for your business is to have a consolidated view. You don't want to look at multiple tools to find out what was the issue in application, what was the issue in your web client, what was the issue in your infrastructure. Because you need to have a consolidated view. You can't be juggling among multiple tools to see where the issues are. So what you will do, you will end up integrating all of this yourself in your console because all of us want to do that, do some integration ourselves. But when you start integrating multi-vendor tools, this is how it will be. So I followed up with another question. Is all well? Is everything fine when you are using this technologies like this? Then they gave me, no, Raji, I have this. I found this issue. There is this issue. Some small issues. Nothing in any specific order. I'm just going to talk about 12 problems in using a multi-vendor tool for any of your monitoring solution. So before I go into this, I just want to quickly find out how many tools are you all using? We have a survey for that. Amanda, can I have that being posted? So the number of tools that you are using for your monitoring.
Okay.
So if at all you're using any
So we've had 13 people respond, and just under 50% said four or more.
Sorry? You have run that already?
Yeah, I've just run that now, literally about a minute ago.
Okay. Sorry. I was in a different screen, so I didn't know that was run. So I'll just continue. Yeah, fine. Perfect. So I'm just going to present, these are all self-explanatory, nothing in any specific order. When you're using multiple tools, what are the problems that you end up having? So first is about, it's not first, second, I'm just giving it in the random order that I have. Multiple invoicing. You have to deal with multiple invoicing. When you have to submit for your tax filing, when you're using multiple tools, you have to collect all of them, put together and submit. So multiple invoicing is a problem. Multiple billing cycles. Because each tool has its own billing cycle. Some of them will be pay-as-you-go model. Some of them will be use it for 6 months or 4 months free, and then you will have to pay for it. Some of them will be a monthly package. Some of them, the names will vary. One of them will call it as gold, silver, platinum. The other will be business, enterprise, advanced. So handling multiple billing cycles is an issue. Multiple logins. How many of you remember all the logins and passwords that you have in your system? At least I don't. My system, my browser remembers most of them. Because each of them comes with its own logic and its own philosophies. One of them will say password has to be a combination of uppercase, lowercase, a number, and a character. Another one will ask for two-factor authentication. In one, it will be renew it in 45 days. In another, it will be renew it once in 6 months. It's impossible to remember the multiple logins. That's again a problem when you're using multi-vendor tool. Multiple interfaces is an issue. Because we are all used to seeing something in the same place, something called as muscle memory, right? We go and do the same thing again and again without noticing. In one tool, the close button of an alert will be in the right top corner. In another, the right top corner is a delete. How do you remember? You go, you think that you're closing it, and you'll go and end up deleting it. I have faced this many times when an interface changes, whatever tool we use. In one, the red color will be a indicate showstopper. In another, it will be critical. It's not possible to remember. So multiple interfaces is again issue. Security breaches, right? You can make sure your system is secure, but how do you make sure the multiple tools that you're using are all secure? Because hackers will only try to enter through the loose ends that you have. The multiple tools that you use, if there is one leak or one hole in one of the tools that you're using in your production system, your entire production system is gone. So security breaches is again another issue. Training and retraining. Every tool comes with its own training manual. Every time a new release is done, or every time a new person enters or leaves your organization, you have to take care of training, and that's again another issue. Access control, right? This, I have faced this. I'm sure all of you would have faced this as well. Each tool calls it in a different terminology. One of it says it as owner, administrator, user, sub-user. In another tool, it is called as dashboard viewer, DB administrator, account owner. And how do you remember what user access you have given for your employees in which tool? You cannot remember, and you will end up giving admin access for everybody. So that's what most of the time happens. Every time somebody comes and say, I don't have access for this, but to do this particular action in this particular tool, you will not be able to handle it, and you will end up giving administrator role for everybody. So access control is another issue. Data problems. When you want to integrate these multiple tools, each of them comes with their own data. One of them will give the output in JSON, another will be giving it in XML. So integrating them will be a problem. There are diverse roadmaps. One of them releases quickly, follows agile methodology. Another one follows waterfall and has 6 months once release. How do you make sure you take all these roads? You can only travel one road or follow the roadmap of one tool. It's not possible to do it for multiple tools. Stuck in older technologies. If you are using a tool which is stuck in older technology, you are also going to be stuck in older technology, because that tool will require you to use the browser, the older version of browser. Another tool will ask you to move to the latest version of the Chrome browser. How do you do that? So that is again another problem. Hidden cost. I've heard this from some of our customers themselves. When they use a product, they train their entire workforce to use that product. After a year or after 2 years, there is a sudden surge in the or sudden increase in the price. You cannot go ahead and change the system because you have trained your workforce for that. So cost is hidden cost is again another issue. Longevity is a big question. You are out there to do business for a longer run. How do you make sure all the tools that you are using are going to come along with you in the long run? If they go out of business or become being acquired by somebody else, the culture may not set and you will not be, you would have purchased it keeping something in mind, but it will keep changing or they may go out of business. So that will end up an issue. So these are some of the problems that that people told when they are using multiple tools. So the success of a set of tools depends not on how well they work. It depends on how well they work together. So integration is needed in this, is the need of the hour in this connected world. But integrating multi-vendor tools is both complex, as I said in the very beginning, the information spaghetti that is, and costlier. It's going to give, it's going to cost you heavily with respect to both resources as well as the cost of the product. So what is the alternative? Try to use services and tools from single vendor. Could be any vendor for that matter. When you are using tools for your production setup, make sure that you have it simple. Use one tool that can give you all the metrics that you want in one single console. So if you are using a tool to monitor your public URLs, you must be able to use the same tool to monitor your private URLs as well. Don't choose a different tool. If you are using a tool for monitoring your backend application performance, use the same tool for monitoring your front-end application performance. The same tool should have the capability. If you are using a tool for service performance metrics, then there must be an option for the platform component performance. You must have an option to write your own script and do some metrics, collect some metrics. All those customization should be possible. If when you're using a tool for monitoring your IIS web servers, when you have IIS web servers, it will list all the applications, the .NET applications. And to find out the .NET applications performance, you should not go for another tool. The same tool must be able to give you those as well. When you're using your for monitoring cloud servers, it could be EC2 or Azure or any cloud server, you may need to take some action. You may have to go and start or restart a server. So all those automation should be possible because SRE deals with a lot of automations. So your tool must have capability of automations, running scripts, and taking some actions. So there are many tools out in the market. Site24/7 is one such tool that can give you an all-in-one monitoring platform for taking care of all your monitoring needs from one single console. So we do have website monitoring that's doing monitoring from 100 different locations across the globe. There is server monitoring to monitor your servers, be it your physical servers or virtual servers, your Linux, Windows, all servers and server metrics, and cloud monitoring for your public cloud, private cloud, public cloud for AWS, Azure, GCP. So all those cloud monitoring is there. And then for network, we have router, switch, firewall, all the components will be monitored. APM, applications performance troubleshooting for Java, .NET, Ruby on Rails, PHP, and Node.js applications. Real user monitoring to know actually how your real users are using across the globe. What's the ISP behind which they are using? What's the browser and version that they are using? Are they facing any JavaScript errors? How do you take care of all these from a single console? Application logs in this distributed environment, in this microservice architecture world, where we have our servers distributed across the globe, you need to look into the logs to see what the problems are. You cannot take remote control of each of those systems, go log into that system and see what the logs are. A central console that fetches all the logs from different locations and gives you in one view is what is application log feature. Cloud spend is for analyzing your spend in the cloud. How much are you spending? Because a lot of time, there are unwanted spending that we do in the cloud. The tool will be able to tell you and give you some guidance report for optimizing your resources. Status IQ is for publicly displaying your status of your pages. You have to be transparent with your end customers and communicate with them to say if there are any problems or if you're going to do any maintenance. So that is data cycle. All these put together, and on top of it, do you have alerting, reporting, and AI capabilities is what is Site24/7. There are many tools out in the market. Site24/7 is one such tool that can help DevOps and SRE. So it's not something new. Many people have asked, is this a new product? It's from Zoho, one of the products from Zoho. We started way back in 2006, and we have slowly added on top of it whatever the features the customers asked, whatever the features the market demanded, and how the market is shaping towards, we just added more features. We launched with websites, and then we added API. We added global point of presence, the mobile apps. Then we added server monitoring capabilities, APM and cloud monitoring capabilities, real user monitoring, network monitoring, Azure app log monitoring, the cloud spend. All these were added as and when it was required. And this is a mature product in business. We have been, customers have been using us for the past 13 to 14 years now. We are run on Zoho. So we have 10 different data centers across the globe in 5 different regions. So we have a primary and a secondary data center, one in the US, one in Europe, one in India, one in China, and one in Australia. This is mainly to make sure that your data resides within your global geographical boundaries, because people don't want, now so many laws and regulations have come in, people don't want their data to go out of their country. So we have all these data centers. If you want, you can choose the Australian data center and have your data reside only within the Australian boundary. We do take care of security and compliance very seriously, and we are ISO 27001:17:18:27701 certified, and we are also have this GDPR. We are GDPR compliant, and we have SOC 2 certification as well. Every year there will be serious audits that are happening. So all the I'm saying all this to make sure that we do take privacy very seriously, and customer data is very in a secure manner. So I'm just giving you some points of how Site24/7 stands out, because that's one question that always comes up. Okay, there are many products out there in the market. How do you differentiate? How do you stand out with your competition? So I'm just listing some 4 or 5 points here. We are a full stack monitoring with a complete depth and breadth of features that we do. Whatever monitoring you take, we give you the, it's not just superficial monitoring. We give the complete depth and the breadth. It's a customer we are a customer centric company itself. We have a forums, community forum, where if people ask any question and many people ask for the same feature, the product roadmap itself changes. So we listen to our customers and try to implement all of them. It's one product, one company with high tech, with focus on R&D. Zoho itself has been focusing more and more on R&D research, and we are able to take latest technologies and rewrite our own code wherever needed, so that we are able to give better product to our customers. Solutions are organically developed, so they talk with each other very seamlessly. There is no problem with any integrations and things like that. Value for money, cost effective. So that's again one of the features which people have talked about. We give all this at a very competitive price. So I'm almost towards the end. Just a quick recap of why SRE itself is essential. I talked about various things. I talked about the architecture, application architecture evolution, and then how I see DevOps and SRE, why monitoring is important, when what are the SRE challenges, and when SRE is to use the monitoring tools, when they are using multi-vendor tools, what are the problems and why they should go for a single tool, can be any tool, and Site24/7 is one such tool available in the market. I'll give you a quick recap of why SRE itself is very essential. So when I say this why, I was reminded of this book, Always Start with a Why, by Simon Sinek. So you can go read for it. This is the crux of what he talks in that book, the golden circle. Why, then how, and then what. Why is the very purpose for which any organization or any methodology exists. How is the process of doing? What are all the metrics or what you collect? So if I have to put this for SRE, why SRE? SRE is taking care of the reliability at the production setup. That's why SRE is essential. SRE is the center core who takes care of the trust and reliability at the production setup. So that's why SRE are. How do they do that? They have to use monitoring tools. It's not possible for them to do without the help of monitoring tools. Use any tool in line with your business, in line with your customer needs. You have to choose the tool, right tool, and use them. And what are they using it for? What are their roles and responsibilities of SREs? So I can categorize them as they have to take care of availability, they have to take care of performance, they have to take care of capacity planning, they have to take care of change management, they have to take care of emergency response. Some incident happened. How quickly are they able to respond? They have to see what the problem is, what the root cause is, and respond to end customers. Use AI capabilities so that they can be proactive rather than being reactive. Before a problem comes, how can I take care of things? There are tools that will help them and make sure they automate a lot of things so that they make their day-to-day lives easy. These are some of the roles and responsibilities of SRE, and they can use monitoring tools, and they are the center of any system who takes care of reliability at the production setup. So with that, I've come to the end of my session. Just take a screenshot of this, or we will be posting this in the chat session as well. When you sign up using this URL, you get 6 months free subscription. This, we are giving this as a token of our giving back to the society so that people can make use of this tool and use it for their monitoring needs.
Thanks heaps for that. Thanks heaps for that, Rajin. And we are going to put the link on the chat. So
yeah,
if you missed taking a screenshot, that will be on there in the next couple of minutes.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you so much.